At the close of Episode 8, the Chosen Children were routed, having narrowly escaped a near-death encounter with the villainous Devimon. So Devimon makes plans to hunt them down one by one, and he sends more of his black gears throughout the broken pieces of File Island, bringing his sinister purposes to fruition. Now that the children have been separated from each other, we'll see within the next few episodes just how they cope in their splintered state. Episode 9 begins with Taichi and Agumon being thrown onto one of the snow-covered islets. There they recollect themselves. Miraculously, Taichi happens to find his clothes there. They're covered in ice. Now, what are the odds? And no, I really mean that. What exactly are the odds that Taichi would find his clothes in the exact location that he lands? This isn't a miracle simply relegated to Taichi, either. Every other child finds his or her clothes exactly where they land as well. No explanation is given for this, and I'm dumbfounded as to why the writers thought to create the circumstances that would lead to the children losing their clothes when they were just going to conveniently have them the very next episode. Alongside this oddity, I should also mention that Taichi gets Agumon to help him thaw his clothes out. So Agumon couldn't spit fire when Leomon attacked them earlier, but now he can? And then Agumon scorches Taichi's pants in his attempt to thaw them out, but later we see Taichi wearing them, and they don't look burnt at all. What the hell is going on with the continuity here? I don't want to think of the writers as simply not being careful about their craft, but what other conclusion can one come to here? Now, the plot really isn't hurt by this, but even so, it's noteworthy in that it tells us something about the quality of each episode and the show in general. Anyway, Taichi takes out his telescope and notes that they're floating farther and farther away from Infinity Mountain. As he contemplates their next move, he and Agumon are attacked by a giant snowman named Yukidarumon. Yukidarumon's been infected by a black gear. Working together, Taichi and Agumon manage to remove it, and Yukidarumon thanks them by providing them passage to a neighboring island, where Yukidarumon mentions that he saw Yamato and Gabumon. Using his powers, Yukidarumon freezes parts of the ocean, creating a bridge, and the three of them use it to cross over to the neighboring island. In the meantime, Yamato is making his way about that island, searching far and wide for Takeru. His worrying for his younger brother overrides his concern for his own health as the cold weather threatens to freeze him to death. Eventually, Yamato collapses in the snow, and Gabumon is forced to carry him into a nearby cave. There, Gabumon makes a fire, and even goes so far as to remove his own fur coat, risking his own health and well-being in an attempt to keep Yamato alive and warm. Yamato recovers the morning after and gives a heartfelt thanks to Gabumon. I haven't made it a point to harp about the English language version of the show in comparison to the original version, but I feel it worth mentioning how the English language version has Yamato say something about how he thinks Gabumon must look pretty silly without his fur coat. Now, given how conscientious Gabumon has been as far as his fur coat is concerned, I don't see Yamato as making this kind of comment. Eventually, Taichi and Yamato are reunited, and all seems well at first. However, there's this unspoken tension between them, something that started in Episode 3 and will reach a boiling point here. Now that they're not surrounded by anyone else, Yamato can basically say and do what he wants here without having Takeru watch him lose control, and without Sora to calm things down, like she did when he and Taichi were arguing in Episode 7. So when it comes to deciding what they're to do next, Taichi becomes very dismissive of Yamato's desperation, and so Yamato becomes incensed with him. Taichi's whole attitude really gets to Yamato here, and he runs off. The instance is comparable to his running off in Episode 3 after he told Taichi about the state of his family. In this instance, however, Taichi takes off after him and tackles him to the ground. Taichi urges Yamato to see reason here, insisting he knows how he feels. But instead of listening, Yamato starts a fistfight with him. A lot of what is said leading up to the fight is superficial. The argument Taichi and Yamato get into is what course of action they are to take. Yamato insists that they find the others, while Taichi continually shoots down every suggestion he makes as to how they go about doing that. However, Taichi doesn't come up with any alternatives, but simply suggests that they regroup with everyone else as soon as the islets have made their way across the ocean. Essentially, both boys want the same thing, right? So why would they fight? Well, for Yamato, this is cathartic. He needs to work through his issues. And Taichi unwittingly provides him with that means. The divorce has really damaged Yamato. It messed him up. He had a good thing going with Takeru early on in their lives, but he was robbed of his opportunity to fully adapt to becoming an older brother. But his parents ran away from their problems, and so too does Yamato try to run away from his. But this time, Taichi ran after him and stopped him. Yamato's need to face his problems is analogous to his fighting Taichi here, which is why I asserted that this whole fight is cathartic to him. Before long, Yamato is in tears, and he confesses to Taichi just how worried he is for Takeru. This shocks Taichi, and for good reason. Taichi has a younger sister, and so he can empathize with Yamato on this level. Taichi has been established as being brave but impulsive. We've seen him come through for his friends, but at the same time, we've seen him do things that would be otherwise detrimental. Now, this is just in a minor sense, annoyances like him tugging on Gabumon's fur coat or slapping Koshiro's laptop. Regardless, the other children put up with Taichi. His antics were mostly harmless. Here, however, he digs the fork in a bit deeper than we've seen, and it didn't just start with Yamato. While Yukidaramon was helping them cross over to the islet, Taichi was teasing Agumon about having an inferiority complex. Agumon didn't take too kindly to that. Then later he made a passing comment about Gabumon's cold, which Yamato didn't appreciate because he was making light of a very dire situation. And then we know he gets very dismissive of Yamato's plight. So we see here how thoughtless Taichi can be, and it conflicts with any previous perceptions about his leadership capabilities. This is a glaring weakness on Taichi's part, and one that he's not keenly aware of, and it's something that he will have to overcome in the future. So regardless of the fact that a fist fight is the way that Taichi and Yamato resort to hash out their differences, by the end of Digimon Adventure, these two boys will have established the strongest bond of friendship among the children. In fact, the strength of the bond is largely due to their willingness to fight each other in order to bring their innermost conflicts to some kind of resolution. Disregarding their own safety, Taichi and Yamato nearly fall off a cliff during their fist fight. As their Digimon partners attempt to rescue them, they're all attacked by another Black Gear-infected Digimon, an abominable snowman named Mojiamon. However, with Yukidaramon's help, the Digimon partners are able to eat and recover. Agumon and Gabumon are able to evolve, and they destroy the Black Gear. The battle with Mojiamon also reveals a network of Black Gears underneath the islet, and Garurumon proceeds to blast them, which causes the islet to reverse its course, heading back to Infinity Mountain. As the episode closes out, Taichi and Yamato clasp hands, and we see that in spite of their fight, they're still willing to be friends. Their situation resolved, we then turn to Koshiro, who has landed on a jungle-like islet where the ruins of an ancient temple reside. Koshiro is set on investigating the ruins, in spite of Tentomon's insistence that they go search for the other children. Inside the ruins, they find a giant black gear embedded in the floor, and Koshiro properly asserts that it's controlling the movement of the islet. He then turns to the surrounding walls, about which are the runes he had come to familiarize himself with in Episode 5. So after discovering a conveniently placed power outlet, hidden within what appears to be a tree root, Koshiro gets to deciphering. In the meantime, Mimi happens to land on an islet adjacent to Koshiro, and she's being assaulted by Sukumon, a Digimon who looks like golden poop, and shares a symbiotic relationship with Chumon, a pink mouse who sits atop his head. Like the Numamon in Episode 6, Chumon throws his own feces as a form of an attack. I don't know what it is about the writers constantly throwing Mimi into situations where she encounters these kinds of Digimon. Regardless, Sukumon chases Mimi down and attempts to steal her back. However, the light of Mimi's Digivice has a strange effect on him and Chumon. Their nastiness dissipates, and they offer to help Mimi find Koshiro, whom they happen to see on the nearby islet. Mimi and Palmon grapple to it, and just in time before Sukumon starts hitting on Mimi. Meant to be funny, of course, but like I mentioned in Episode 6, it's just weird and sick. I think Mimi would tend to agree. When Mimi finds Koshiro, naturally she's overjoyed. Koshiro, on the other hand, doesn't pay her much attention. One might assume he would be happy to see her, or anyone else given the circumstances. I mean, they just survived nearly being killed by Devimon, right? But Koshiro has other priorities here, and they're straight if one thinks about it. After all, he is trying to find a way to reverse their course. But Mimi grows impatient with Koshiro, and she starts to cry when he ignores her. Palmon runs up to Koshiro and pleads with him to be more thoughtful of Mimi's feelings. Even so, Mimi storms off into the ruins, with Tentomon following behind, trying to console her. They lose themselves in the ruins. Koshiro reveals to Palmon that the ruins are a maze, and apparently, it's next to impossible to find one's way out without a map. Not only is the maze, well, a maze, but it's also full of traps. So in order to help Mimi out, Koshiro tries to connect to a kind of PA system networked throughout the ruins. Mimi is still distraught, blaming Koshiro for her current predicament. However, Tentomon is quick to defend his human partner. He admits that while Koshiro isn't very sociable, he's still a good person who means well. When I talked about Episode 5, something I didn't mention was the reason why Koshiro isn't the one leading the group. After all, Koshiro is certainly the most intelligent of all the children, and he seems to know a lot more about the digital world than anyone else. But Koshiro isn't a people person. The way I like to put it is that if you're not a computer, then Koshiro doesn't know what to do with you. Koshiro proves that while his intelligence is very useful, it doesn't make him more or less any virtuous. Mimi responds to Tentomon, saying, "But it's true that in his eyes, I'm out of consideration." I don't think I would have second-glanced this particular line had I not seen Digimon Adventure Torii, but this line would hint at a particular fondness that Mimi has developed for Koshiro. There's even the fact that Mimi refers to him as Koshiro-kun, although I'm not familiar enough with how Japanese honorifics work to know exactly how she's using it here. Anyway, Koshiro makes contact with Mimi and begins to guide her back to the entrance. However, as he does so, he discovers something is stalking her within the ruins. A Beastman-type Digimon like Leomon's classification. This one is Centaurmon. Half man, half horse. And a black gear protrudes from his side. Mimi and Tentomon are chased by him and reach a dead end. Or seemingly so. Eventually, Koshiro and Palmon break into that room from the outside. The Digimon partners evolve here and destroy the black gear, causing Centaurmon to revert back to his normal self. Centaurmon explains that he is the guardian of the temple, and that he recognizes the children's digivices. According to Centaurmon, the digivices are holy relics, made to guide the world towards the light and drive away the darkness. Right on cue, Leomon appears and he attacks them. However, he's driven off when Koshiro and Mimi raise their digivices, threatening to evict the evil presence from within him. After Leomon runs away, the children make a return to the main room of the temple, the room where Koshiro found the giant black gear that was steering the island. Koshiro is about to settle down to his computer again, in an attempt to reverse their course back to Infinity Mountain. However, even as he does so, Mimi angrily kicks the black gear, and somehow that causes the islet to change its trajectory. Here, Koshiro admits to Mimi, "Just like you said, there are many things I should try out physically." However, I do not recall Mimi ever extending that advice to Koshiro, here or in any episode previous to this one. Even so, how does simply kicking the gear cause it to go in reverse? Seems to me that's an enormous design flaw. Nevertheless, we move into episode 11, where we find Joe's bed has landed in the water. Poor Joe has become seasick, and Gomamon does his best to relax and comfort him. Before long, they're attacked by Ogremon, who happened to be inside a great wooden box that collided with the bed. Fortunately for them, Gomamon consumed the emergency rations in Joe's bag, which gives him just enough energy to evolve into Ikakumon. He and Joe manage to escape, and Ogremon is left unable to chase after them because, well, he can't swim. However, Joe can't swim either, which proves highly problematic when Ikakumon, weakened by the fight, reverts back to Gomamon. It seems they're about to drown, but they're saved just in time by Sora, who happened to be fishing nearby. Lucky! Well, Joe happened to pass out after nearly drowning, and as he recovers, Gomamon requests that Sora and Piyomon make Joe their leader, as a means of boosting Joe's confidence. Sora agrees to this, and when Joe wakes up, they all declare that he's to be their leader. Joe is reluctant at first, but eventually he takes to the task. Funny here is that Joe becomes a bit overzealous, and Sora's surprised when she sees a side of him that she's never seen before. The group hears the sound of bells in the distance, and they go to investigate a nearby chapel. Sora argues with Joe for a bit on the baseless assumption that there must be humans there. But she capitulates, as she made Joe the leader after all. As they draw close, Joe seems to have been proven right. They spy a group of people dancing in a circle nearby. A man in a mask invites them inside, explaining that the festival is in honor of Bakemon-sama. However, Gomamon voices his skepticism at giving reverence to Bakemon, who by his estimation is just a simple ghost Digimon. Piyomon seconds Gomamon's opinion. The masked man is none too pleased with their assertions, but this is because he and the other humans are actually Bakemon in disguise. As I mentioned about Devimon in episode 8, the Bakemon all hide their true forms. In this case, the white sheet is not their actual exterior. It simply covers what they really are. And what are they? Well, according to the Digimon Analyzer, nobody knows. This is all noteworthy because Bakemon don't just show up here, but they also serve as common foot soldiers for Vamdemon later on in the show. Considering the thematic elements that I talked about concerning Devimon's aesthetics, those same elements are also prevalent heading into the Vamdemon invasion arc. In other words, the powers of evil are associated with hiding, covering themselves, deceiving others, etc. The Bakemon easily capture the children and their Digimon partners, the latter of whom are too weak to evolve or fight. The children are then prepared for some kind of ritual sacrifice. However, to downplay the horror of it all, the Bakemon are portrayed as extremely cartoonish, as they season Joe and Sora using two comically large salt and pepper shakers. Gomamon and Piyomon are also able to take out the Bakemon guarding their cell thanks to some slapstick antics. Now, the Bakemon are classified as adult-level Digimon. Yet, it seems they're about as powerful as your average child-level Digimon. However, when they gather together, they transform into a single Bakemon, which is far larger than the rest of them. So I'm confused here. Is Bakemon a giant ghost that can break into smaller ghosts, or vice versa? Regardless, this giant Bakemon is driven back thanks to the timely arrival of Gomamon and Piomon. They recently tricked a Bakemon into giving them food, and now they're able to evolve into a Kakumon and Bergamon. However, even as Sora and Joe escape their bonds, the giant Bakemon proves extremely elusive, stymieing Akakumon's missiles and Bergamon's fire. Joe gets an idea here, asserting that because Bakemon is a ghost, then he'd be weakened by prayer. Once again, his display of confidence impresses Sora, and she aids him by lending her helmet, which he uses as a tempo drum. Miraculously, Joe's chanting works, and Bakemon is weakened enough for Akakumon and Bergamon to finish him off. Bakemon's death leads to the islet rupturing down the middle, and through the crack, Joe and Sora see Devimon's black gears grinding to a halt and later falling apart. It cannot return to Infinity Mountain. Well, fortunately for Joe and Sora, their Digimon partners are capable of sea and air travel, so they're not left stranded. Even though this episode features both Sora and Joe, this is more of a Joe-centric episode. Now, this is unfortunate, as the separation period between the children's first and final encounter with Devimon gave the audience an opportunity to see how the children would function more as individuals, rather than within a group. Sora doesn't really receive that kind of scrutiny, because more attention is placed on Joe. Joe has a really small arc here, where he proves that he can be quite resourceful when the occasion calls for it. As I said before, Sora is genuinely taken aback by this change, and she shows great surprise when Joe's plan works. It's possible that Joe wouldn't have been given the opportunity to boost his confidence here if he'd been teamed up with any other child, save Takeru. Sora respects Joe and is one of the only children to refer to him as Senpai, due in part his seniority, but also because, as we learn later, Joe's older brother knows Sora's father. So one assumes they were acquainted well before the summer field trip and the journey to the digital world. Unfortunately, as the show continues, Joe settles into more of a follower role than a leader, and he's pushed farther into the background, making room for the big four, Taichi, Yamato, Takeru, and Hikari. When we get to the Vamdemon invasion arc, I'll endeavor to explain how Digimon Adventure Torii seems to backtrack on Joe's character progression, as it seems that his evolution in Digimon Adventure counts for very little as far as he's been portrayed in Adventure Torii. Finally, we move into episode 12, where we find Takeru and Patamon have landed on an islet all by themselves, unlike the rest of the children who were able to reunite with at least one other child and Digimon partner. Takeru and Patamon aren't so lucky. Takeru is inconsolable after having been separated. Patamon follows along, upset over the fact that he's still the only Digimon partner yet to evolve. Funny here is that Takeru only stops being upset when he needs to comfort Patamon. Takeru then tries to imagine what kind of Digimon Patamon will evolve into, and he comes up with some very childish but funny creations, which for the most part Patamon is averse to. These include the pig-like, "It's probably like this mon," with its special boo-boo attack, or the hippopotamus-like, "It must be like this mon," with its special hippopotamus vacuum attack. These are all displayed on an imaginary Digimon analyzer. Takeru's creations seem to be poking fun at Akiyoshi Hongo's conceptions, as many of the Digimon within the franchise have elongated names that encompass several different aspects at once. For example, names like Zed Millenniummon, Ultimate Chaosmon, Black War Greymon, or Belial Vamdemon. At a certain point, you'd think Digimon would adopt actual names, as opposed to being referred to by their species all the time. Regardless, Patamon dislikes Takeru's creations and insists that he stop, and so they move on. As they journey, they discover the Village of Beginnings, a place full of giant toy blocks, and the ground itself is made of a plush, bouncy material. Infant Digimon and Digimon eggs are scattered about the village, and Patamon explains that this is where Digimon are born, hence the name. Takeru is thoughtful here, remembering a time when he and Yamato were still living together. Via flashback, we see how Yamato would care for Takeru when he was very little. Here we see how attentive Yamato was, and we can better understand how the divorce robbed him of future opportunities to be the kind and gentle older brother that Takeru remembers he was. So as they mine the eggs in the infant Digimon, Takeru and Patamon are then attacked by Elecmon, a badger-like Digimon whom also happens to be the caretaker for the Village of Beginnings. Patamon in particular doesn't take well to Elecmon's attitude, and the two Digimon brawl for a bit before Takeru breaks them up. Unbeknownst to Takeru, Patamon was on the verge of evolution here. In order to settle things between them, Takeru initiates a tug-of-war, a means of proving one's strength without resorting to violence. Episode 12 is exceptional in that way, in that it's the only episode where a conflict is resolved without evolution and subsequent combat. Patamon eventually overcomes Elecmon in this tug-of-war, and Elecmon is thrown into a large pillow in the distance. Feathers scatter about the area as Patamon and Takiro cheer at their victory. Now humbled, Elecmon congratulates Patamon and gives him and Takiro a proper welcome to the village. Takiro says something very interesting here about how friends may fight amongst each other, but they make up later. Then he mentions adults, but he trails off. Of course, he's referring to his parents and their inability to make reparations. Some of the dialogue that occurs after Elecmon's defeat is confusing, something I chalk up to bad writing. Elecmon says he's going to visit other Digimon on File Island in the hopes that, if their hearts unite, that will cause the island to reform. Okay, so let's say the digital world works that way, all's well and good. Except how did he plan on traveling to all the pieces? There also seems to be some lines missing from the episode, as Elecmon makes mention of the Pyokomon village the children passed through in episode 4. But Takiro and Patamon never mentioned that to him, so how would he even know that? Regardless, it's not even confirmed whether or not Elecmon's plan works. The island does reform in episode 13, but it seems to come as a direct result of Devimon's defeat. The episode closes out with some foreshadowing for the upcoming battle with Devimon. The feathers that burst from the pillow are an omen for Angemon's death and resurrection. Additionally, Elecmon remarks on Patamon's strength. A small body often harbors a great soul. Devimon himself admits that the only Digimon he really fears is Patamon, the only one yet to evolve. It's only a matter of time before we see that happen.